Blessed be the one, holy and living God. Glory to God forever and ever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive. Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
God be with you. Let us pray. O God, whose blessed Son came into the world that he might destroy the works of the devil and make us children of God and heirs of eternal life, grant that having this hope, we may purify ourselves as he is pure, that when he comes again with power and great glory, we may be made like him in his eternal and glorious kingdom, where he lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from Joshua. Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel, and they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to all the people, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, long ago your ancestors, Terah and his sons Abraham and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates and served other gods. Then I took your father Abraham from beyond the river and led him through all the land of Canaan and made his offspring many. Now, therefore, revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt and serve the Lord. Now, if you were unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods, for it is the Lord our God who brought us and our ancestors up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did those great signs in our sight. He protected us along the way that we went and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in the land. And therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God." But Joshua said to the people, "You cannot serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions or your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, he will turn and do you harm and consume you after having done you good." And the people said to Joshua, "No, we will serve the Lord." Then Joshua said to the people, "You are witnesses against yourselves that you have chosen the Lord to serve him." And they said, "We are witnesses." He said, "Then put away the foreign gods that are among you and incline your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel." The people said to Joshua, "The Lord our God we will serve, and him we will obey." So Joshua made a covenant with the people that day and made statutes and ordinances for them at Shechem. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now let us say Psalm 78 in unison. Hear my teaching, O my people. Incline your ears to the word of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will declare the mysteries of ancient times, that which we have heard and known, and what our forefathers have told us, we will not hide from our children. We will recount to generations to come the praiseworthy deeds and the power of the Lord and the wonderful works he has done. He gave his decrees in Jacob and established a law for Israel, which he commanded them to teach their children, that the generations to come might know, and the children yet unborn, that they in their turn might tell it to their children, so that they might put their trust in God and not forget the deeds of God, but keep his commandments.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Thessalonians. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring him with those who have died. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself, with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will be with him forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. The word of God for the people of God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout, 'Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him.' And then all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise replied, "No, there will not be enough for you and for us. You'd better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves." And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he replied, "Truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." The Gospel of the Lord. Then Joshua said to the people, "You are witnesses against yourselves that you have chosen the Lord to serve him." And they said, "We are witnesses." Joshua said, "Then put away the foreign gods that are among you and incline your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel." You may be under the impression that you don't know much about the book of Joshua. But my guess is that you are more familiar with its stories than you think. In this book, we read about Rahab, the sex worker, who offers a rooftop hiding place for the Israelite spies. And then we read about the Israelites crossing the Jordan River and the Battle of Jericho, in which the city's walls come tumbling down. In this book, we hear about the complicated journey of the Israelites as they pass from the wilderness and begin infiltrating the land of promise. This book confirms that the promises made to Abraham about an abundance of land and descendants have finally come true. At the end of Deuteronomy, God chooses Joshua as Moses' successor. And Joshua wastes no time transitioning into this new role of his. I thought I would offer a very brief synopsis of the sixth book of the Old Testament, because we hear from it so infrequently in our lectionary. The first 12 chapters tell the story of Joshua guiding the Israelites across the Jordan River and into a multitude of battles and conquest with the Canaanites, who were already living in the promised land of Canaan. After several confrontations in the west and the north and the south, Joshua and his people claim the land that God promised them generations earlier. Chapters 13 through 22 detail how the land should be distributed among the tribes. Chapter 23 is Joshua's goodbye speech. He reiterates how critical it is that the Israelites refrain from both intermarrying with the Canaanites and worshiping their gods. Joshua affirms God has given them all that was promised and warns that if they worship other gods, consequences will follow. Today's reading that we hear is from chapter 24. And it's a renewal of the covenant made between Joshua and the people on behalf of God. Four verses after our reading ends, we learn that Joshua dies at the age of 110 years old, and the book comes to a close. But back to our reading today. Joshua asked the Israelites big questions that demand big answers. Now that their settlement is finally complete, the Israelites must embark on their new life in a new era. No longer will they live as nomads. Now they are permanent residents of the cities and farmlands of Canaan. Finally, they have arrived at this promised land, this land where they have directed every bit of their physical, emotional, and mental energy for the past 40 years. But Joshua knows that arriving here is not the end of their work. Now they must live here. Their journey continues. Today we hear Joshua challenge them The Israelites must decide where their divine allegiance lies and what their identity will be as God's chosen people. What will they do? How will they live? Will this new generation of Israelites act with justice? Will they hold fast to their founding principles? And of course, the most crucial question, will Israel be faithful to their God, the God who called them out of Egypt, the God who guided them for 40 years in the wilderness? This is a tremendous task for Joshua for several reasons. One is that he is quite aware that not all the Israelites support him as their leader. Not everyone likes him. Not everyone agrees with him. And he doesn't possess the gift of having all these dissenters swallowed up by the land like Moses did. He has to live with them. But Joshua isn't just the leader for the Israelites who support him. He's the leader for all of the Israelites. Joshua sees the confusion on their faces as they settle into their new land and begin their new life. He summons up the tremendous courage and calls them all together. He calls his supporters and his dissenters and holds all of their feet to the fire, so to speak. He begins by summarizing the Israelites' history before God. He tells them about their ancestors who worshiped other gods before they discovered the Lord, the God of Israel. This God took Abraham and led him through Canaan and multiplied his offspring. God then gave Abraham Isaac, and to Isaac, God gave Jacob and Esau. On and on it goes. Joshua continues recounting all that God had done for Moses and Aaron. He recounts the great liberation from Egypt and the crossing of the Red Sea, and the Israelites love this retelling. They are overwhelmed with gratitude, and so when Joshua asks if they will worship the God of Israel exclusively, they immediately proclaim, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods." But Joshua knows his people. He's hesitant to believe their quick agreement to serve the Lord. He replies pretty harshly. He says, "You won't be able to do it. You're not good enough. Do you know how hard it's going to be giving up all your idols once and for all?" But the Israelites aren't discouraged. They stand up a little taller and they brush the dust off their shirts and they reply to him, "Yes, we can. We will serve the Lord." And I imagine Joshua smiling as he replies, "Then you are witnesses of your own oath." Today begins a new day, a new covenant for a new generation. And with new eras come new covenants, promises from all of us about a new way that we will live. I retell all of this story because I think it has so much to offer us this week. It reminds us of something that we're missing on the national scene. In the midst of a new life in Canaan, Joshua demands that the Israelites think about their relationship with God rather than their relationship to the land. Together, they make an intentional decision to reaffirm their covenant with God, to renew their promise of faithfulness and sacrifice to God. Our country's election season is finally coming to a close. And whether you greet this new day with anticipation, resignation, frustration, or even ambivalence, it is time for a new covenant. It has been an extremely long election season and an extremely long year. And right now, we have the opportunity to examine our country and what is to come of our future as a nation. And as we do so, it is imperative that we also examine our faith and our allegiance. What will we do? How will we live? And I am most certainly talking about renewing our covenant with God, our God, not with our government. As involved as we may have been with both local and national campaigns, no matter the number of postcards that we wrote or phone calls we made, we are Christians first and Americans second. Our cross always comes before our flag. Now is the time to discern and articulate our covenant with God. Joshua's story reminds us that as we enter new phases in life, we should take time to renew our religious commitment and our relationship with God. We've lamented as a nation about getting through this horrible year, but surely we know that 2021 won't magically erase our past. Our slate isn't wiped clean on January 1st. We will still wrestle with politics, white supremacy, climate change, and COVID-19. And yet, we have the opportunity to note that something is new. So we must ask the same hard questions Joshua asked the Israelites as they settled into their new land, starting with, what do we do now? Joshua offers suggestions as we consider renewing our relationship with God. He asked Israel to consider two things as the foundation of that covenant: sacrifice and faithfulness. Sacrificing the old idols to embrace the faithful love of God. So, as we look at our own relationship with God, we must ask ourselves, what idols need to die? What other gods prevent us from fully worshiping God? How will we be faithful to our God? How will we live our faith in this complicated time? How will we live out our faithfulness in this new covenant? Like the Israelites, the end of this election season and the end of the calendar year offer us the opportunity to intentionally shape our self-identity and to identify with God. In our reading today, Joshua makes clear what hasn't been implicit all along, that this is a moment of covenant renewal for the people. The result of this new covenant is a renewed understanding of Israel's relationship to God. Israel is God's chosen people. God has been involved in their history leading up to this new era. And on this day, when Joshua asked the Israelites what God they will serve, Israel proclaims proudly that not only are they God's chosen people, but Yahweh is their chosen God. Like the Israelites, God has chosen us as well. We are God's chosen people. God has been with us all along, throughout our tumultuous history and throughout this extremely long year. Now is our time to make the bold statement and declare that God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is our God. Now is the time to renew this covenant and decide for ourselves how we will live. Amen.
Let us join with believers around the world as we profess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And now, in peace, we pray to you, Lord God.
For all people in their daily life and work, for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone, for this community, the nation, and the world, for all who work for justice, freedom, and peace, for the just and proper use of your creation, for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression, for all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble, for those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy, for the peace and unity of the Church of God, for all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth, for Michael, our presiding bishop, and Scott, our bishop, and all bishops and other ministers, for all who serve God in his church, for the special needs and concerns of this congregation. Hear us, Lord, for your mercy is great. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King, and praise your name forever and ever. We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them who put their trust in you.
Gracious God, you have promised to hear what we ask in the name of Christ. Accept and fulfill our petitions, we pray, not as we ask in our ignorance, nor as we deserve in our sinfulness, but as you know and love us in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier, rest upon you this moment and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.